Hi, Behrend from UBC, and I will embarrass him by reading his prize citation. Professor Behrend is an internationally recognized leader in the field of algebraic geometry, whose contributions to the subject are noted both for their depth and scope. He has obtained fundamental results in the theory of algebraic stacks, Gromov Witten theory, and the study of the Donaldson Thomas invariants. In particular, his pioneering works in the construction of the virtual fundamental class played a key role in laying the algebraic foundations of the Gromov Witten theory. Later, he made a breakthrough in the study of the Donaldson Thomas invariants by showing that perfect spaces, the degree of the fundamental class could be expressed as a topological Taylor characteristic, weighted in a certain way, and this function is now known as Behrend's function. So the ideas put forward by Behrend have already really immensely influential, and will undoubtedly have a lasting impact. So Kai studied in Germany. He got an MA at Eugene, Oregon. His PhD in 1991 from the University of California in Berkeley. He was then a Moore instructor at MIT before coming to UBC in his 1991. His research has been recognized by several significant awards, including the Professor James and Geoffrey Williams prizes at the Nobel Prize. And he gave invited to the 2014 ICM Congress. So, and today he's talking on orbit folds and eigenvalues of the Hi.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So I'm going to talk about orbit folds and eigenvalues of inertia. Of course, I'm going to explain what I mean by both these terms. And so a lot of my talk is, I think, going to be just be spent on the first part. but I want to start out by talking about counting, because in some sense, everything is counting, what I am interested in today. So accounting associates to a finite set of points the number of its elements. So, finite set, you get the number of elements. And there's a natural generalization, which is the signed Euler characteristic of a manifold X, say, and this is just simply Euler characteristic sub C, I call it, minus 1 to the dimension of the manifold times topological Euler characteristic of X. So that naturally, if the manifold is the finite set of points, this is just the number of elements. This function obeys some basic rules, so obeys basic, I can call them counting rules. So the first one is often known as the scissor relation, or scissor property, scissor. If I have a manifold X and Z is a closed submanifold, and then I have the open complement, I have this additivity. So this just says scissor relation, because I think of cutting open the manifold into two pieces, and then the count should of course be additive That's one of the most basic counting properties. The second one is the multiplicative property. So if I have a product that obeys the product property. So these are the two basic counting rules I learned in elementary school, and they're satisfied here. These two properties are already enough to actually calculate. You don't need to know the definition of this thing in terms of cohomology, Durham cohomology with compact supports or something. You just need these two properties to calculate. So so this already allows you to calculate. So for example, the Euler characteristic of a point, right, the point acts with respect to multiplication as identity. If I multiply a manifold by a point, it doesn't change. So you see that the Euler characteristic of a point is 1 from that axiom. What about the real numbers? For example, there's a picture of the real numbers, and the real numbers is the same as just two copies of the real numbers and a point in the middle. So this is, so by the scissor relation, so I have two copies of R, so that's twice this characteristic of R, and then plus the point, so that's 1. Plus 1, and from that you can deduce that R I get minus 1, which of course you could have also, if you know what this is, deduced from this formula, but it also follows from this property. And so then by the multiplication property down here, you get that Rn has counts as minus 1 to the n. For example, if you look at the circle now, the circle is made up of a copy of R and a point. So by the scissor relation, 1 plus this number here, so minus 1 is 0. How about S2? Sphere. So now the sphere. Okay, so this is R2 and a point, so you get 2, I mean all these, I don't know, if you want, for example, a closed surface with G holes, you get 2 minus 2G, etc. That's just examples of this counting thing. There's one property that is follows from these two properties. That's I want to call it division. So if that is about the following, if I have an unramified covering, so unramified covering of degree D, for example, the complex plane mapping to the complex plane with the squaring map that wraps, that's a 2-to-1 cover of the complex plane by itself. This is an example of this. Then I have the Euler characteristic of X is D times the characteristic of Y. So I call this the division property because I can compute the base, the Y in terms of X by dividing by D. And I'm going to be interested actually, of course, not just in counting, but as I said, you can see from this example that these two rules determine everything. So in some sense, what am I saying? I want to talk about the universal counting rule. So I guess I should make a definition. What is a counting rule? So a counting rule is a map. So in our case, from, let's just call it chi, from all manifolds to R, which is some ring. So that's just some domain where I can add and multiply. So such that these two rules over there are obeyed. And with this is plus and this times is inside that ring. And then, so this particular counting rule I've been talking about over here has values in the integers, as you see. And if you have an arbitrary counting rule, you know, there's just a unique map here. Or the unique map makes this diagram. So this, in some sense, this is the universal counting rule. Every counting rule comes from it by such a diagram. That's just because it's uniquely determined by these axioms. But now I don't want to just count points in manifolds like these kinds of things. I want to count mathematical objects. So so really I'm interested in counting things like vector bundles on a algebraic variety, but since I don't want to, I mean, I want to give a somewhat more general talk, instead of talking about things like vector bundles on a manifold, I want to talk about like the simplest example of a mathematical structure I can think of. So for example, let's count triangles. So Euclidean triangles, as you know them from Euclidean geometry. And we're interested in triangles up to similarity. So, maybe I could put all the triangles into a space, and then the Euler characteristic of that space would be the count of the triangles. And so I want to attempt to write down such a space, and I'll call this M for moduli space. And since I'm only interested in triangles up to similarity, I can rescale them all so that the sum of the three sides is 2. So I'll say that A plus B plus C is equal to 2. And then I'll say that A is the shortest and C the longest side. And then I need to make sure that I have a triangle inequality satisfied. So this is a space that describes all triangles. And so I drew a picture of it. Let's see if it's going to come up now. Oh, there it is up there. So up there is this a picture of because of this linear condition, right? This is a two-dimensional part of the plane. So it's a two-dimensional thing in three space, and there it is drawn. So there's the endpoints there. So up there is the actual picture of M, and below is a picture of all the triangles. So if I have a point in M, here down here is a corresponding triangle. And so you can see that along this edge here, there's like the isosceles triangles, which are acute. Down here, they're the obtuse isosceles triangles. And then there's the equilateral one, and then there's all these scalene ones. And this line down here is not part of it, because that's where the triangles degenerate. So if I, it's not really a manifold, this thing, because it's actually a manifold with boundary and even a corner, but I can cut it open to consist of manifolds. So, if I remove the boundary, so all the blue triangles, they're all the isosceles ones, I'm just left with this open triangle. So that's like an R2. And so that contributes 1. Then I have these two one-dimensional pieces. They're open intervals, so they're like R. So they both contribute minus 1. So that gives me minus 2. And then I have a point. So that gives me 0 altogether. But I'll tell you right away that I consider this to be the wrong answer, because it doesn't take into account the symmetries of the triangles. So, in fact, if you think about it properly, triangles form an orbifold, not a manifold with boundary and corners. So, Yeah, so I want to actually justify why is that so? So this is wrong because M, I mean, even though it, you know, every triangle corresponds to a unique point in M. Right? Every triangle up to similarity corresponds to exactly one triangle here and to one point in M. So there's the one-to-one correspondence between the points of M and the triangle. So that looks like I'm getting exactly what I want, but you see, if we look at families of triangles, so think of a triangle slowly deforming into other triangles. So I've got some pictures for that. So let's see if I can. Okay, so now. There, at the top, so you see two families of triangles. So it starts out with this right triangle there. I slowly deform it to this isosceles triangle, and then it goes back to a right triangle. So the first picture up there in the upper left, so the upper vertex sort of moves across. There's the other family there. It does the same thing. Except for that vertex at the top, instead of moving across, it just moves halfway and moves back. And then I can, since both of these, you know, one-parameter families of triangles start and end at the same triangle, I can glue them together in a unique way into, you know, families of triangles parameterized by the circle. So I have a circle and a family of triangles above the circle. And in the first case, so actually, the second case up there gives me the untwisted family there. The first case gives me this twisted family that has a Möbius twist in it. Because if you look at the first example where, you know, as I move along, the longest side was C in the beginning, but at the end, the longest side is B. So this is a switch between what's the longest side. And so there's an ambiguity that you know, if you think about what happens when I glue it together, I get this family with a Möbius twist, and the other one is just it's untwisted. But right, but for every point in this parameter circle, I get a corresponding triangle, and therefore a corresponding point in M. And so this family determines a map from the circle into M. So I've drawn this here. This is like, it actually starts out here on this line of right triangles, goes to this boundary of isosceles triangles, and then just retraces itself. That's like this loop here in M. But point-wise, they're exactly the same family, so they give the same map to M. So both of these families, even though they're completely different, one has this Möbius twist, the other doesn't, they give the same map. So they give the same map from S1 to M. So same, I call this the moduli map for different families. And so that's already like the essence of orbifolds and stacks is in this, that you can, so really to, you know, to reflect all these twisted families properly, this M is not good enough. So instead, I'm going to introduce N. So N is bigger. So again, triangles have a circumference too. But now I just say A and B and C are all less than 1. And unfortunately, apparently, to switch to the next picture, I have to So this is this bigger M. M is this just a sixth of it, as you can see. That's the M that I had before, and now that's the bigger N. And so now, in fact, N, this is really corresponds, so points in N correspond uniquely to labeled triangles. So labeled triangles come with the size labeled A, B, and C. So, right, then I can't require that A is less than or equal to B, less than or equal to C anymore. And every, because every triangle has six ways of labeling it, every triangle occurs six times now instead of just once. Right, except for the symmetric ones, they occur fewer times. In fact, the number of times a triangle occurs is six divided by the number of its symmetries. Okay, so that's the picture of N. And now, whenever I have such a family, the moduli map, now because every triangle occurs six times, the moduli map will be multi-valued. So moduli maps namely six-valued. Whenever I have a family member, a triangle, there's six ways to label it, and then I get six corresponding points in N, except for at the symmetric triangles. So I wanted to show some pictures of that phenomenon. So for example, a family where all the triangles are scalene, no symmetries whatsoever, is the very first picture up here. So there's just, a loop of triangles corresponds to six loops in N, and they're all like reflected across, like in the first picture. Here's a family with a Möbius twist, like I had before. So there, to get the Möbius twist, I have to hit this equilateral triangle, and there I hit the equilateral triangle, and I go across this boundary, and so then it sort of winds itself back, and so the ways to label a triangle are they twist, and that's why I get So the labels of the ways to label a triangle are twisted in this example. And there's another example where I can also have a family instead of just doing a reflection and then going together, I can do a rotation if I have an equilateral triangle. No, I don't need an equilateral triangle, but anyway, there's an example of a six-valued moduli map. Anyway, so that's that. So all of that is supposed to convince you that, so this fancy M, that is the orbifold of triangles. And that's this N, and this is a 6-to-1 cover, and it's unramified. This is basically the reason that if you have a family and you've labeled it in some way, if you deform the family a bit, the labeling moves along uniquely. So if I use this division property, so let's say that the count of this orbifold of all triangles is 1/6 times the count of N, but N is just an open triangle in the plane, so it's just like R2, so it has 1. So the correct count is 1/6 and not 0, as I got by just looking at N. Sorry, M. M, which is, by the way, the coarse, it's known as the coarse moduli space. Okay, there's the division property. Sorry? Yes. Yes. Right. Yes, so thanks for pointing that out. So this thing now going from orbifold to Q is accounting, obeying also the division axiom. And it's not hard to see that the counting axioms, sum and product, plus division, determine this counting function for all orbifolds uniquely as a rational number. So if I include this counting rule, I again get a unique way to count the orbifold, and I get 1 over 6 for this particular stack of triangles. Okay, let me just, I can't resist to say, so this is one example, counting triangles up to similarity. Just to think, to convince you that it's not just silly, this is very closely related to a very important problem in geometry, actually. So counting elliptic curves is very, very closely related. So, because every time I have a triangle in the plane, 3 points, P1, P2, P3, and let's say it's in the complex plane, and then I can construct a Riemann surface over the complex plane, two-sheeted, which is ramified exactly at these 3 points and at infinity. So I can do some kind of branch cuts and then have this Riemann surface with these two branch cuts, and that's, by the way, the Riemann surface of this function, if you know what that means. And such a thing is known as an elliptic curve, because if you try to do these period integrals, they're elliptic integrals. Anyway, so for every triangle, you get in this, you know, this Riemann surface, this elliptic curve. And so triangles in C give elliptic curves. Every elliptic curve occurs in this way if I let my triangle, I have to allow triangles to degenerate, so, you know, into a line. And the elliptic curves are isomorphic if and only if the triangles are similar, oriented similar as though. So the curves, so get the same elliptic curve if and only if the triangles are similar, oriented similar, sorry. So I'm not allowing reflections anymore, symmetries, they all have to, only rotations any longer. So that's my last picture. So this is if I look at oriented triangles, I get twice as many. Right, so now triangles that were distinct before, sorry, equal before are now distinct, and so my coarse moduli space is twice as big as it was before. And let me just count these. So let's say E is this orbifold of elliptic curves. And so, well, maybe write the formula here. So I think one of the things we learned here in this example is that every object actually is weighted by the number, well, 1 over the number of its automorphisms. This is like a general rule. So the contribution of the, so contribution of the equilateral triangle, for example, is 1 over 6. So all the asymmetric elliptic curves, those correspond to the scalene triangles and the equilateral, sorry, the isosceles ones, not the equilateral ones. The isosceles ones aren't symmetric anymore. But since, you know, you really have to imagine the thing bent around, and so the asymmetric ones contribute zero because that's like a punctured plane. It looks like a punctured plane. And the asymmetric ones, so this is from the asymmetric ones. So the equilateral triangle contributes, now it's only its rotations are allowed, so I get 1 over 3 from the equilateral triangle. So that is J invariant 0 for those who know the kind of stuff. Then there's another symmetric one is this line segment here, which is bisected. That has a rotational symmetry. So that gives 1/2. This is the bisected line segment. And then so the rest of the degenerate triangles, they break up into these two lines. So now I'm including the degenerate triangles at the bottom, but this completely pinched one at the edges is not included, and the one in the middle, which is this one, is not included. So I really have two line segments again. So I get minus 2 for each one of those. This seems to contradict to my... Well, one thing... what is this? This is... for some reason, this is supposed to be 1. I don't know. Anyway, it's anyway wrong because I haven't taken into account another symmetry of elliptic curves, namely the cheat exchange. So really, it's 1/2 of all that. And that's supposed to get me minus 1 over 12, which is if I evaluate this, that S equals minus 1. Anyway, so that's all. So the thing is that if we talk about orbifolds instead of manifolds, no one forces us to put this division property that forces these numbers on us. So we can have more general counting rules. There exists more general counting rules for orbifolds. Just as an example, let me, I don't know what to call this, just put a subscript p on it. So it goes from our orbifolds to this ring here. One variable for each prime number. And if I have an orbifold, which is a, sorry, I'm using a word that is kind of technical. So whenever the automorphism group, the symmetry group, doesn't change, then I talk about a gerb. So like if I just look at the isosceles triangles, they all have the same symmetry group, Z mod 2, and they form a gerb over the coarse moduli space, which is this union of two line segments. And that's that. So I can map that to the Euler characteristic of the coarse space times xp to the rp, or prime numbers where the number of elements in the group is easily, it's not hard to check. So this is another property. So it doesn't satisfy the division property, but it satisfies the two basic counting property union, additivity and multiplicativity. And so, but the universal one, so the universal counting rule is, I guess we just write it like square brackets. So that goes from the orbifolds to that's just a completely formal construction. You take these formal symbols on all the orbifolds, you generate a ring out of that, and then you just impose the two counting relations and get this universal, you can get this ring here. And every counting rule, for example, this one comes from that one via a map like this. Okay, so so maybe I should get them to, it's maybe enough for now on orbifolds and counting orbifolds. No. The thing is that these kind of unramified covers of manifolds, they're always locally trivial in the topology, but in orbifolds they're not. For example, the one that that our main example, that is not. No, it's not. It's just not locally trivial, unless talk about like Ital topology or something. Okay. So algebraic case. So in the algebraic case, what are you talking about here? Okay. So as I said, our goal is to count bundles or sheaves over a smooth, just have to say these words, and projective variety X. Okay, so now we're always working over the complex numbers when we're doing algebraic geometry. One side effect is that there's no odd dimensional things, and so we have this this signed Euler characteristic. It's the usual Euler characteristic, but the worst problem. So there's a problem here that right. So So objects always contribute to the Euler characteristic with the weight, one over the automorphisms. But now these kind of objects that we're interested in, they're linear. So these are linear objects, which means that the C star always acts by scaling on them, right? Is always contained in the automorphism group of any object. And so, that has Euler characteristic zero, so in some sense the weight we'd have to put would be 1/0, which doesn't make sense. So how do we get out of this problem? So there's different ways out. So one way out, don't use this counting function, which has values in the integers or the rationals. Use a enriched counting function. So So I'd use a counting, I've called them counting rules, with so the thing is actually the two counting rules, the additivity over the scissor relations and the product rule, they don't determine even the count of the complex plane. In fact, you can prove that you can take any, you can assign any value to this to this number and get a consistent theory. So we can take just a formal variable, for example. And that leads to a consistent theory. And then, you know, your problem, then the count of C star is Q minus 1. And then you can divide by it. You don't have this problem anymore. So 1 over Q minus 1 exists. Mm. And I should do this. This is silly to have this. You could even use the universal counting rule. Or another way out would be, another idea would be to notice that, well, generic objects should have the fewest possible number of symmetries. Like for the triangles, this generic triangle has no symmetries. So generically, these sheaves or vector bundles or these kind of objects should have only the smallest possible number of these automorphisms, C star. So so the generic object should be as asymmetric as possible. And so the automorphism group should be just C star. And objects with this property are called, I don't know, it's a bad word, but indecomposable. I mean, just because an object is indecomposable doesn't force it to have this, but if it weren't if it was decomposable, it certainly does not have that. So people start, call these things indecomposable objects. And so then you could just count the indecomposable objects and say, okay, they all have this 1 over Q minus 1. Just multiply everything by Q minus 1 and then evaluate the counting function and you get a count. So then count these with weight 1. Just get rid of that factor by force. So, of course, the thing is that in algebraic geometry, we don't only want to count these asymmetric objects. So, so there is, in fact, a whole theory of semi-stable and stable objects, and stable sheaves, and these are indecomposable. So, this approach would work for stable sheaves, but, to get a really good theory going, you also need to include semi-stable sheaves. So a semi-stable sheaves, such as, for example, just trivial rank 2 bundle. This needs to be included in the theory. So, that's due to the fact that actually there's a whole theory there's different notions of semi-stable, and semi-stable varies, and then there's wall crossing phenomena, and to get all this theory going, you really need to work with semi-stable sheaves such as this one too. And so, so the automorphism group of such a thing is actually just the general linear group GL2. And what is the count of GL2? Well, if I use a more general counting theory with Q, so these are 2x2 matrices, right? So the first column has to be non-zero, so that corresponds to the plane, which has Q squared minus its origin, which has 1. And then the second column has to be linearly independent from the first. So you see that that gives a plane minus a line, Q squared minus Q. So this semi-stable sheaf should contribute 1 over that. Which has a pole of order 2 at Q equals 1. So a pole of order 2 at Q equals 1, as you can see. And so then, just multiplying by Q minus 1, you'd still can't set Q equals 1 as you want to. So what to do? So the suggestion is to take the residue. Q equals 1. So expand this out, it looks like a rational function with a pole of order 2 at Q equals 1. So you just compute the residue. And actually, this is, which is, so what did I say? Q minus Q squared minus 1 times Q squared minus Q. The residue at Q equals 1 of this is minus 3 over 4. So this should be the contribution of this trivial rank 2 bundle. Anything with automorphism group GL2 should contribute this number minus 3 over 4. And so, what we really want to do is we want to define the residue of a stack. Well, in algebraic geometry, we say stack instead of orbifold to define the residue of a stack at Q equals 1. Or more generally, even expand a stack and powers of 1 over Q minus 1, but actually I don't just want to expand, calculate this value. I really want to expand the stack itself. So, and I want to write here C star, because this is just notation for the stack consisting of one object whose automorphism group is C star. That's just the name for that. And so that, as we see, should have contribution 1 over Q minus 1. But now I don't want to just think of it of its count, but of its actual stack. And I actually want to expand stacks and powers of these things. That's really what's going on. So that does have this one side effect of giving extracting the correct count, for objects with more complicated symmetry groups. But it also gives a whole new theory of so I should have said at some point, so the universal counting rule for stacks. So again, it's just a formal construction. So take all stacks, generate an abstract ring out of that, and then introduce the two counting rules. And so this is this ring, the ring of motivic weights, it's called. And in this ring, I want to expand objects in this ring in powers of this element in that ring. So, So this is where the inertia operator comes in, which I'm going to talk about at the end. But for now, what is it going to do for us? This is going to be an operator on this ring of motivic weights of stacks, operator with eigenvalues. So there's certainly eigenvalues q minus 1 to the r. And then the projection into the q minus 1 to the r eigenspace, right, that should be the so give the expansion. So the is the so I'm actually imitating this thing, what I can do for rational functions of Q, expand them around a pole, and get these various Laurent coefficients. I can do this in this big abstract ring of stacks using this inertia operator, which will decompose this thing into these various contributions. So, and I should say that doing this and working this all out in detail, so this is joint work in progress with my student Julia Ronach. And there's also the ideas of Bridgeland and Joyce are very important and motivating and so I have to explain this inertia operator. What is that actually? I've got 10 minutes for that. Okay, so here's the inertia. So since I want to be concrete, and I'm just going to go back to the triangles and explain this in the context of triangles. So this was all this was my algebraic geometry interlude, and back to the triangles and orbifolds. So X an orbifold, and X its coarse space. So the example you should have in mind is this orbifold of triangles, and with M, right, that thing as its coarse moduli space. so what is IX? By definition, And these are the loops in X which are invisible in the coarse space. Meaning they give the constant loop when I, so they're loops to X, so when I map to the coarse space, I get the constant loop. So for triangles, that would mean, loops of triangles. I had lots of loops of triangles up there. But now I'm only looking at loops where all the members of the triangles, all the members of the family are similar to each other. They all give the same point. They're just one triangle. So the only way I can get loops then is, so I go along this interval and the triangle always stays the same, but somehow I have to glue together at the end when I close up the circle to make a closed family, closed loop. And so there I have to glue these two triangles together which are the same triangle. And so it's only about a symmetry from this triangle to itself that will make this family. So these kind of loops are actually just, so these are the same as pairs, actually. An object, namely a triangle, namely the shape of that triangle of my loop, and then a single automorphism of that triangle. So now if I'm looking at the inertia of the triangles, I'm not looking at triangles, but I'm looking at pairs, triangles and symmetry of the triangle, object and automorphism. So that's what the inertia is. So what does it actually look like for the triangles? So there's like several components. Here's, on the one hand, there's this thing. Right, the stack of all triangles, which was M, was represented by this N, this big triangle with this degree 6 cover, right? So this is really, there's a copy of M corresponding to just the objects and the identity. So these are just families that are also exactly completely trivial. I just glue by the identity. So then I have isosceles triangles with the reflection. Right, there's the isosceles ones have the reflection, and so I can make Möbius families out of those either Möbius or no. So this is, but the pair of the triangle and the reflection still has an automorphism, so this is still, so this is a Z mod 2 automorphism everywhere. And then there's the equilateral triangle, and it has a rotation. That's the only triangle that has one-third of a whole circle rotation. And so but that pair of objects still has a Z3 automorphisms. Namely all symmetries of the triangle that commute with the given rotation. So that's a picture of the inertia of M. It consists of those three components, right, corresponding to the different kinds of automorphisms triangles can have. But maybe I want to consider something even simpler. Let's just restrict to only equilateral triangles. And so then this orbifold of equilateral triangles is called BS3. It's just a point. There's one equilateral triangle, but it has this group S3 as automorphisms. And so the inertia of BS3, if you think about it, the inertia had to do with actually conjugacy classes in this group S3, right? These reflections and rotations are actually the conjugacy classes in S3. And so what you get in the simple case is just, so what is this? So this is by definition inertia of BS3, which is, okay, so disjoint union over all conjugacy classes in G, B of the centralizer. So that's just a point with the centralizer as, okay, so actually this is true for all groups. In the case of S, well, okay, this was, maybe I should say this for an arbitrary group here, my calculation. So there's the central conjugacy classes where the centralizer is 1, so there I just get, where the centralizer is the whole thing. So I get the number of elements in the center times BG, to get the whole group, and then I get plus the sum of all the G, which are non-trivial conjugacy classes. Yeah, I wanted to get to this calculation. So for example, you see that if the group is abelian, all the conjugacy classes are central, this contribution isn't there, and all you're doing is multiplying your BG by the number of elements in the group. So you see that the number of elements in the group is an eigenvalue. I just, there's the first eigenvalue. So if G is abelian, okay, I'm running off time, so let me quickly say, so the inertia of BS3, so there's the center, which consists only of one element. Then there's the three reflections with a centralizer Z mod 2. And then there's the two rotations with a centralizer Z mod 3. So that's our basic group theory, just using this formula here. With this formula, sorry? No, there's three conjugacy classes. And there's these three things. I've just restricted to the point in the middle here. I have these three components here. If I apply inertia to this thing, I get the sum of these three things. If I apply inertia to this thing, well, I get twice this thing because it's an abelian group. Here I get three times this thing. So inertia applied to this thing generates a submodule invariant under inertia. So I have, BS3, BZ mod 2, and BZ mod 3 invariant under I, and here's the matrix of I. So this is my basis. So I apply I to this guy, I get 1, 1, 1, each thing once. I apply to this guy, I get twice itself. And to that guy, I get this. And you see, right? No, yes. The three-dimensional subspace of the whole, K of orifolds is inertia acts on this thing with this matrix, and you can see it's diagonalizable. That's the point I wanted to make, because even though it's not diagonal, there's three distinct numbers on the diagonal. That's up lower triangular, so it's diagonalizable, and the eigenvalues are 1, 2, and 3. And so it's a easy exercise using this formula to generalize this to arbitrary groups and prove that. So for orbifolds, I has spectrum, the positive integers. Yep. And it's diagonalizable. And the general theory in algebraic geometry for art and stacks goes along the same kind of arguments. And so sorry for going over time, but I did want to include my linear algebra in the talk. So, thanks. I don't have an answer to that question. The eigenvectors. Oh, so I you can of course easily do this calculation and diagonalize that matrix, but I did it. So for example, you have an eigen. So this gives you an eigenvectors.
That matrix you get E as 3 minus E as 2 minus 1/2 3. This is 1 and 2, that to 2 of course you just get E as 2 and 3 get E as 3. So every in every number has all the abelian groups with that order as eigenvector. But there's more interesting eigenvectors too. Well, in general, I don't recognize this kind of thing, you know, so I don't really know. Doesn't fit into any pattern we know already about kind of groups. You can really say, okay, the eigenvectors are these things that, well, I can say the eigenvectors operator must have something to do with my group theory. I don't know. Well, if the group is infinite and discrete, then we don't consider it to define an algebraic stack. But of course, the infinite groups I talked about were things like, the example in algebraic geometry was things like group GL2, which of course is infinite. And then, somewhere I think so GL2 has a generates a subspace invariant under inertia, which I've written down somewhere. It's very similar with it. So there is a three distinct eigenvalues on the diagonal. Again, you get a three-dimensional. It's more complicated because there's only in GL2 there's only two conjugates in the process. I forgot something. In this whole theory of the algebraic groups, we always restrict to semi-simple inertia. So we only look at the semi-simple elements. And semi-simple elements in GL2, it means they're diagonalizable and the eigenvalues are either distinct or equal. And so you get two different conjugacy groups. semi-simple quantum physics class. And so it's a surprise that you have this third guy there, and also gives a very strange eigenvalue, which is not the power of q minus 1. Q minus 1 times q plus 1. And so that is due to some phenomena that some certain covering is not split. You have a degree 2 covering current symbol when you start applying inertia to it. It's a degree 2 covering, which if you force that division axiom that I talked about, you get rid of that. Sorry, of course they're not two conjugacy classes. Things like lambda mu, where they're different. There I have that this many